So let's get to an actual calculation example based on the GM310B power analyzer, and we need to take a few practical considerations. We focus on the electrical inputs for the power analyzer only here today and are not including any transducers. As our measurements involve square wave, thus with modulated signals, as we are measuring on an inverter, best practice is to measure in wideband, so without any filter supplied. This is also the way in which the GM310B specifications are given. One thing you might consider is specifications with filter enabled, as calibrations are done on sine waves, would give us more favorable results in calibration. But as they do not represent real life, we have chosen to do this all in wideband. Also, all the specifications in the GM310B datasheet are given as pass-fail limits. So let's take a look at our use case. What are we measuring? We are measuring AC power, 24 kilowatts at 600 volts and 40 amps root mean square at a frequency of 500 hertz and a power factor of 0.8. The current we are measuring with a CT, an HBM CT type in a 50 amp RMS range. As announced, we focus on the power analyzer calculation only, but we need the datasheet on the CT to determine the secondary current output and it shouldn't to be used for the calculation of the power analyzer measurement uncertainty. So from the datasheet, I have the snippet here, we can see the ratio is 1 to 500. So if we put 40 amps into the CT, the secondary side will output 0.08 amps root mean square, in fact. So let's get to reading the GM310B datasheet. Let's first take the coarse and easy approach. If you look at table on page 6, this gives us a lookup table, and it gives us all the info we need for our calculation. So we need to find the values we determined earlier in this table. One is the power factor. So we mentioned it's a 0.08 power factor, which fits this range between 0.5 and 1. The voltage we are measuring directly with the input is 600 volts RMS. So that means we are looking into this input range here. The current we measured with the CT results in a secondary current of 0.08 amps RMS. So that means we are in this current input range. And then last but not least, we have our frequency of 500 hertz. So we need to go into this column here. Let's see, it would be this one. And combining this column with this row tells us we will have a 0.055% of reading error and a 0.02% of range error. So this is the data we can now feed into our measurement uncertainty calculation for the power meter. Those are the tolerances we found, as mentioned. The measured value is 24 kilowatts, we determined already, and the measurement range is our voltage multiplied by the current, so it's 30 kilowatts. Now we calculate each independent error first with our correction factor of 0.58, as we want to bring this rectangular shape distribution back to Gauss, as that's the base measurement uncertainty. Calculate the individual errors in watts, and then we can use the geometric addition, which is taking the power of 2 of both values, adding them up, and taking the square root out of the results. So we know now the measurement uncertainty at this specific measurement point is 8.41 watts for a K is 1. As a percentage of reading, this is 0.035%. And K is 1 indicates what is the coverage of this result, what is the certainty of this result. This is a sigma is 1 value, basically. Now, what if we want to have a more accurate result, as that's possible as well? The most accurate approach uses the table on page 5, which gives us all the info needed to do the full calculation. So we feed the values we found earlier into the equation we get from this table. So then the reading error is again 0.58 times the formula we get from taking the reading error for the relevant frequency here, which is 4.87 watts. We do the same for the range error, again do the geometric addition, and we see now our error is 5.99 watts or 0.024%, which is lower than what we calculated earlier with the table. Let's have a few words on why this is the case. If you look at this table, this is always the worst case scenario. The higher your frequency is, the bigger your measurement uncertainty basically gets. So the values we see in this column basically correspond to 1 kilohertz. In this column would be 10 kilohertz. This one would be 100 kilohertz. While we are in fact measuring 500 hertz, so we are midway this range. Now, if you use the formulas from this table in page 5, we calculate actually the measurement uncertainty for 500 hertz instead of 1 kilohertz, which we take from the cable table. That's why we get, in the end, the lower measurement uncertainty. Another thing regarding reading data sheets to consider, by the way, is we just discussed the electrical inputs. But for anyone doing motor analysis out there, did you ever consider the measurement uncertainty of the inputs used for your torque and speed measurements? Those are frequency inputs, those are counters, and they have a specific uncertainty as well, which you should add to your measurement uncertainty calculation. So what I show here is just a few screenshots of the uncertainty contribution of the timer counters of the GM310 boards. So you can use those either to determine the additional measurement uncertainty on your torque or on your speed signal. In case you are using an HBK or HBM torque transducer, we in fact have the results immediately calculated in here for your convenience. So just something to consider.